A great pleasure to present the results we obtained on the formation of two-dimensional electron and all gases at the head-to-head and tail-to-tail domain walls in ferroelectric thin films. Now, most of the work that we did in this particular course can be found in this particular reference, which is actually online. This work was done in collaboration with Pablo Garcia from the University of Cantabria, George Manyali from Kaimosi Friends University College, George Amolo from the Technical University of Kenya, and Javier Junquera from the University of Cantabria. My name is James Sifuna. Let's discuss about domain walls. Now, domain walls in ferroelectrics, but giving a bias on tetragonal ferroelectrics. In our case, we used lead tetanate. Lead tetanate belongs to the important family of electrical materials based on the cubic perovskite structure. Now, at a temperature of 765 kelvins, lead titanate will actually undergo a single phase transition from the paraelectric cubic phase to a tetragonally distorted ferroelectric phase, and then remains in this particular phase till zero kelvins. Now, here, with some additional constraints that the normal component of polarization should be continuous across the domain wall so that no net charge is actually seen at the interface, then we actually left with two scenarios. We either go for the 180 degree domains or go for the 90 degree domains. Now, in conventional 180 degree domains, in tetragonal ferroelectrics, the domain walls will always run parallel to the tetragonal polarization axis, as you can see here. Now, in this kind of configuration, this polarization charge that is defined to be the dot product of polarization and the unitary vector normal to the domain wall will actually vanish, and the domain walls will become uncharged. Now, if you tilt domain walls, we will actually lead to polarization-induced bond charges at the domain wall. If negative charges accumulate on the domain wall here and positive charges accumulate on the domain wall here, then the polarization charge will lead to a large unfavorable electrostatic energy. Okay, and of course you can see here that this charge, polarization charge, is no longer zero like what you saw in the other case. Now, what will happen in extreme scenarios, like what you're going to deal with in this case, where the polarization points in the same direction as the normal vector to the domain wall? This will actually end up giving head-to-head domain walls with a positive polarization charge and tail-to-tail domain walls with a negative polarization charge, you can see here. Then the electric fields that are going to be produced will bend the electronic bands, as you can be able to see here. Okay, now beyond a given critical thickness, the valence band at the tail-to-tail domain walls in this particular scenario will reach the level of the conduction band in the head-to-head domain wall. Then, hopefully, there's a transfer of some electrons to the tail-to-tail, from the tail-to-tail to the head-to-head to screen the polarization charges. That's something you're going to be able to find out in this particular talk here. But one thing you need to really understand is that it's computationally expensive, really challenging for you to perform these kind of simulations, because you have to deal with really long-range electrostatics. And secondly, because we are talking about charge transfer in this particular case, it may be coupled with some lattice distortions. Again, the idea of simulating domain walls implies the treatment of supercells with large number of atoms. That's actually very expensive. And lastly, it's also important to know that the differences in energies between the relevant phases in ferroelectric tetragonal materials are usually very small and need to be very careful when you're doing this kind of simulations. So what is the goal of this particular work? We were tasked to determine the critical thickness for stabilizing the two-dimensional conducting layers in ferroelectric, ferroelectric domain walls. Again, to determine the spatial extension of the hole and electron gases in ferroelectric, ferroelectric domain walls. Again, to determine the value of the polarization in ferroelectric, ferroelectric domain wall in this particular case. Remember that Aguado and co-workers some few years ago were able to determine the value of the critical thickness that could be able to stabilize these two-dimensional conducting layers in a lead titanate monodomain. Then, later on, Yin and co-workers employ the same model now on a ferroelectric dielectric kind of interface. But in our case, we're now substituting this dielectric with actually a ferroelectric. So now have a ferroelectric and a ferroelectric kind of interface, then be able to answer these kind of questions here. Now, what did Yin obtain after following that model? What Yin obtained in this particular case here was he was actually able to stabilize this kind of conducting two-dimensional systems. Because what you can see from this outcome of the results is that there's a signature of electronic reconstruction. And this band bending is simply coming as a result of the remnant depolarizing field, which results from the incomplete screening, okay, that does this kind of band bending. So we now wondered what will happen if we substitute this strontium titanate here with now lead titanate. So in our case, remove the strontium titanate here and have lead titanate. So we have now lead titanate and lead titanate on this other side. Then our surfaces are going to be lead oxide terminated. And of course, they are terminated by lead oxide because lead oxide is simply the only stable surface termination found in first principles. Then we employed a vacuum of around 8 unit cells, and we were able to simulate the domain structure with a 1x1 supercell that is actually periodically repeated in space. Okay. Now, it's also important to note that the central layer here, which is lead oxide, is actually a mirror symmetry. Okay, that's what we did in this particular case. And we were able to employ 16 unit cells. 16 unit cells on the domain on the right and 16 unit cells on the domain on the left. That's what we did in this particular scenario. Then, one thing that we also need to understand is that we began from the parelectric kind of system, whereby the lead titanate atoms were moved in opposite directions in the two halves of the slab geometry, following a displacement pattern of the bulk tetragonal soft mode that was scaled to 62%. Why 62%? This can be obtained easily on the paper that we wrote. Now, from these particular outcomes, our results can easily show, when you check at these polarization profiles, you actually see almost a flat polarization at the interior with 57.26 microcoulomb per square centimeter for the head-to-head and 45.72 microcoulomb per square centimeter for the tail-to-tail. But when you check at the domain walls, you see some variation. Also at the surface, there's a variation in the polarization. This is actually a signature of what we call a localized strong homogeneous atomic distortions. This kind of RAM that you're seeing here. When you check at the energetics here, between the tail-to-tail domain and the head-to-head domain and the parelectric, of course, the two polar configurations are metastable. That's what you found out from our calculation. But out of the two, the most stable phase was simply the tail-to-tail. Because you can see when you check at the energy differences from the parelectric phase, the tail-to-tail has 1.16 while the head-to-head has 1.374. Remember, I said that these kind of energies, the energy differences are simply competing. So they're actually very small. Now, when you check at the PDOS that you obtained from our work here, at the head-to-head, which is this pie, this kind of first figure that I'm calling A, and this is B. So for A, we can see the conduction band here at the interface and the valence band at the surface crossing the Fermi level. At the tail-to-tail, we can see the valence band here at the interface and the conduction band at the surface similarly crossing the Fermi level. Again, This is simply something telling us that we are having some remnant depolarizing field, because it's coming from as a result of this incomplete screening. And you can see this is coming, forming this kind of bending of the bands. In the head-to-head, you can see the bending of the band, and the tail-trail, you can see the bending of the band in this particular case here. Now, for us to talk about the free carriers, it's important to note that the density of these metallic carriers in this particular scenario are actually related to the polarization profile by this particular equation here. So, for us to calculate these particular charges, it's important that we are able to plot the planar averaged value of the free charge, as you can be able to see, where the black is simply plan average, the red dashed line corresponds to the nanosmooth average, and the blue corresponds to the profile magnitude of the bond charge in this case. So we're able to obtain, in this case, the head-to-head head and electron density of 1.03 electrons, and the tail-to-tail head a 0.82 density of the holes. So that's something you can be able to obtain from even the paper that we are talking about. So what is the take-home message? We're able to find the critical thickness that was able to stabilize our two-dimensional conducting layers to be 16 unit cells. And the spatial extension of this hole and electron gases was actually 6 unit cells for the head-to-head and 7 units for the tail-to-tail. Now, how large is the polarization? That can be found from this table here. It's actually 57.26 microcoulomb per square centimeter for the head-to-head and 45.72 microcoulomb per square centimeter for the tail-to-tail. Much thanks to the Catholic University of Eastern Africa, Richard Martin, for enabling this kind of collaboration, the University of Canterbury for offering me a scholarship, and Assessma Community at Large, and the Center for High Performance Computing, where I did our calculation. Much thanks, and I wait for questions. Thank you very much.